Okay, hi everybody. I'm John Lincoln with Ignite Visibility and welcome back to Learning SEO with Ignite Visibility. Today, I'm going to talk to you about a topic that a lot of people have been debating for a really long time, and that topic is URL structure. Okay, so I've got some really good information for you on URL structure, and let's go ahead and jump into it. So the first things first, you want to keep URLs as short as possible. The shorter the URLs, generally the better for sharing on social media and generally just a little bit easier for the user and search engines and everybody else out there. Also, you're going to want to make sure that you put a keyword inside of your URL. So example.com/keyword, you're going to want that to be front and center so that Google can crawl it, Google can index it. They can see that keyword and then they can relate it specifically to the page. But what you don't want to do is you don't want to keyword stuff. So you don't want to put, you know, 5-10 keywords inside of this right here. Otherwise it starts to look spammy. People don't want to share it. Everybody kind of knows what you're trying to do if you're stuffing a bunch of keywords inside of a URL. And actually it's not as effective as it was, you know, 5-6 years ago. And in fact, it's not effective. There's something called a directory structure and something called a subdomain, okay? A directory is after example.com/, right here. The keyword right here would be a directory on example.com, okay? A subdomain would be www.example.com. So the www would be a subdomain. So if it was blog, if it was whatever, .example.com, whatever comes before the example is a subdomain. So you really need to know how to use subdomains and how to use directories, okay? Because there's different times when you want to use each of them. So for a directory structure, generally it's better to do a directory structure and to use a directory, and in most cases I do, unless you are going to be breaking up the site into different topics, right? So if you write primarily on one thing and your site's primarily about, you know, say bicycles, you would do a subdomain if you're gonna have a totally different topic that doesn't relate specifically to the website. You would put that on a subdomain. Also, sometimes people use it for their checkout process. They might put that on a subdomain, have that being secure. But as we know now, we want all sites to actually be secure, HTTPS. So your main site should be secure as well. Directories are generally best for blogs too. So example.com/blog, right? Your blog should be on a directory structure also. Best for categories, best for products, best for international. You can do international, I'll talk about that in a moment, on a subdomain. But it doesn't always really work the best, and I'll talk a little bit about that. So in most cases, directories are the way to go. But there are some times when you're going to use a subdomain, or you might use a TLD, a top level domain, or just a completely different domain for certain situations. But for URL structures, a nice clean directory is a very good way to go. You're gonna wanna make sure that you use hyphens inside of your URL to separate keywords. So in most cases, a hyphen's gonna be the best way to do it and one of the ways that search engines and users prefer. You don't want your URL to be any longer than 2,083 characters. And really, it shouldn't ever be even close to that long. You want to keep it as short and concise as possible for a lot of different reasons. And then you want your URLs to be consistent. One of the hardest things for any SEO professional to deal with is changing URLs. Whether it's a website migration, whether it's a 301 redirect, or whether a URL just changes and they don't know about it, it can really, really hurt your SEO. So for us, we always want our URLs to be consistent as much as possible and not to ever change as long as they're a good URL structure. And we never want them to be dynamic. So some sites build things in a way that basically their URLs will change over time. So maybe they add some new inventory, they just coded it in any specific way so that their URLs will change. And when that happens, I used to have a client that had this, they would get these rankings, they'd be going up to the top, their URLs would change, everything would disappear. They'd get rankings, they'd be going up to the top, URLs would change, everything would disappear. It was so frustrating. And I told this person multiple times to make the change so that the URLs were static. And once we finally got that in place, it really, really helped their SEO. Okay, so now let's look at a specific kind of URL structure optimization from top to bottom, okay? So what we have here is first your homepage. Generally, you want your homepage to be on HTTPS. Most people have it on a www dot. And that's kind of the normal convention. Now, when we drop down to a category page, you would want that to be at /category, right? If you go down to a subcategory, you'd want that to be /category/subcategory, and you'd want to have breadcrumbs up here that show the user how they got there. So ideally, and they even say this in Google Starter Guide, you want to be able to follow the URL path back to where you came from, okay? And then that allows the user to kind of follow back, whether it's through the URL structure or through the breadcrumb path, back to where they got to in the navigation. So that's a best practice for them to know how they got there, okay? Now, when it comes to products though, what happens is that if you have your category, your subcategory, maybe another subcategory, depending on how big the site is, right? And I've optimized websites that are, you know, 5 to 7, 8 categories deep where they've got really niche optimizations, the URL just gets way too long. And also a lot of things can break, right? If things are recategorized, that can break your product URL. And you don't want that to happen. I've also seen that happen quite a bit. So what I like to do is go category, category, subcategory, and however many subs you have, and then eventually, boom, drop it back down to the product level or the page level, depending on what is actually inside of those categories. Now you'll see WordPress does it this way. You'll see most big e-commerce sites do it this way. And that really is the best way to do it. You don't want to have that category, subcategory slug before your product name. You want to drop it down to just the product. Okay, so last thing on URL structures for today. Just a brief note about international. I'm not gonna get all into international and multilingual SEO because it's a big, big topic. We'll do another video on that. But what I do want to talk to you about is when you're structuring your URLs, if you're going to have an English version, a French version, a Spanish version, then you're going to want to put that into your URL structure, and then everything else comes after. All this other stuff comes after that, right? So that the user knows that if they're on the English directory, every single thing in that English directory is going to be in English, or if it's in Spanish, everything's going to be in Spanish, right? Now on the country level, if it's the English in the US, you want to put English-US. If it's Spanish in the US, right, and it's just for the United States, the country level, right, you're going to want to have it be ES-US, right? And then that's how you structure the URL specifically. Now, I didn't get into a lot of other things in international optimization like reflang tags and xDefault, and we'll cover that in another video. But this is everything you need to know, basically, about URL structure and SEO. And I hope this was interesting to you, and I can't wait to see you for the next video. Have a great day.